thank you very much for having me here today. And it is my absolute pleasure to be here among the people of Chennai. This is a city we admire so much for its intellectual depth, for its ability to debate. It has produced leaders in every walk of life at the national and international level. And I just want to say at the very start, before I welcome all our participants in the debate to come on stage today and share their thoughts, that I'd like to thank you all on behalf of the Times Group, on behalf of Times Now, and on behalf of myself and my team who have come in from Mumbai for allowing us to bring this debate to you before all of you. So thank you all very much for coming. Should we start the debate? Is that a loud yes? Yes. I like my audience to participate in the debate. My debates are a little noisy, as you know. I am told that I should restrain my guests. I say I cannot even restrain myself. It gives me great pleasure to first welcome all my six participants today, who I will thereafter introduce to join me on both sides of this panel today. Please give them a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Give them a round of applause. To all my panelists, to the people of Chennai, to the wonderful audience this afternoon, thank you for joining me on this very important occasion of the Times Uncompromised debate here in Chennai. The subject which we will put to debate, and there's always a for the motion and against the motion in the debate, does judicial activism really compromise executive powers? We have three speakers for the motion and three speakers against the motion. I'm not putting the motion to vote at the end of this debate, but all of you in the audience and everyone who is going to watch this, millions of people across the length and breadth of our country, will make up their minds on where they stand and who's the winner and who's the loser. Against the motion, does judicial activism really compromise executive powers? In other words, very strongly in favor of judicial intervention, not interference, I have to my right, and please give them a round of applause as I welcome them, Dr. Subramanian Swamy, senior advocate and president of the Janata Party, now with the NDA, fighting the 2G battle against the government. Fighting very hard, if I may say so. Former member of the Planning Commission, cabinet minister, someone who's been at the Indian Statistical Institute and Harvard. Thank you for joining me, Dr. Swamy. So Dr. Swamy's right. We have former cabinet secretary to the government of India, IAS officer from the 1961 batch, if I'm not mistaken. He studied at Imperial College London, has a master's degree in public administration from Harvard University. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, T.S.R. Subramanian. To his right, one of the most respected legal luminaries in India today, former Chief Justice of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, judge of the Delhi High Court. He's a graduate from Hindu College and has done his LLB from Delhi University. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Justice Mukul Mudgal. Thank you very much. And that's the team that is going to be against the motion today, speaking very, very strongly for judicial intervention. Now, speaking against the motion, to my left, I have great pleasure in introducing, it's interesting to have a lawyer speak for the motion. You know you're speaking against judicial intervention to some extent. C. Aryaman Sundaram, one of the best known lawyers of the Supreme Court today. He's a gold medalist from the University of Madras. He was the youngest lawyer, if I'm not mistaken, to be a senior advocate of the High Court here in 2001, moved to the Supreme Court, and today is one of the foremost lawyers in the country's highest court. Mr. Sundaram, thank you for joining me today. To his left, we have former Mumbai Police Commissioner, M.N. Singh. He's the man who led the investigations into the serial blast in 1993. He has led all the difficult and sensitive departments in Mumbai, whether it's the Anti-Corruption Bureau, whether it's being Chief of Crime, and he has won the President's Police Medal for his distinguished services. It's interesting to have an IPS officer on the panel. Mr. M.N. Singh, thank you for joining me. And to his left, former Comptroller and Auditor General CAG of India, Mr. Vijendra Kaul. Mr. Vijendra Kaul has been one of the foremost IAS officers, civil servants of our country. He is also not from the 61, I think from the 65 batch, from the Madhya Pradesh cadre. He's worked in the United Nations for several years, and today he represents the wealth of opinion that says, no, we must draw the line, and there must be a Lakshman Rekha which must not be crossed by the judiciary in dealing with the executive or with any other part of our Indian institutions. Thank you very much, Mr. Kaul. Thank you to all my panelists. Now, usually in a debate, we have people speaking for the motion who set the debate right. I just want to quote James Madison, the fourth president of the United States of America, who said, and you can use this whichever way you want, the accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary, in the same hands, whether in terms of one person or a few people, whether by hereditary nature, whether in an elected nature or a self-appointed nature, may justly be pronounced to be the very definition of tyranny. Ladies and gentlemen, do judicial decisions breach bounds of constitutional propriety and permissibility? Is judicial activism a requirement to defend a common man's interest? Is it the last court of appeal for the aam aadmi? Isn't it true that judicial activism doesn't exist in a vacuum? It is forced. It is a result of our circumstances. It may be a result of the executive failures in carrying out its own duties. Some food for thought, ladies and gentlemen. Our first speaker in this debate today, speaking against the motion, strongly in favor of judicial interference, is former Chief Justice of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, retired Justice Mukul Mudgal. Please.
Thank you. When one pillar of democracy is dysfunctional or comatose, the other pillars must occupy the space. When the executive does not do his job, then the judiciary has to step in. You said the example of Lakshman Rekha. This is not the mythical Lakshman Rekha. This is a flexible one. The judicial intervention must be temporary, must correct the course, then come back. If it were not for judicial activism, forgotten and weak sections of our society, like prisoners, mentally ill, bonded and construction labor, silent sufferers like rivers, forests, and nature would not have had any audience, anybody to look after them. And it is only because of judicial activism do you see that our environment is being preserved, our forgotten and weak sections of the society are getting a glimpse of what the Constitution promises them. And kindly remember what public interest has brought out. Constitutional appointments by unfit persons, as in the case of Central Vigilance Commissioner. In the High Courts, some examples I'd like to give you. You all remember in Punjab and Haryana, there have been honor killings. Today, there are safe homes for the possible victims of honor killings for 15 days, absolutely safely, with protection. The young couple is given security and a place to stay. The only thing I would say where the court should draw a line is when it appoints these empowered committees to go into environment, mining, other related issues. No committee should be permanent. It should be temporary. Eventually, the power must go back to the executive or the judiciary itself. The auction has one problem, that if you can't auction land, supposing school is to be given land, it cannot compete with an industry, you know, or it cannot compete with another rich school. A poor children's school should get a school by land by allotment. And lastly, I would say that things like water, if they are privatized and auctioned, then the poor would never get it because the profit motive will prevail.
Justice Mudgal, thank you very much for introductory comments. It can also be argued, Mr. Mudgal, that has the judiciary lost faith in the wish of the executive or the earnestness or genuineness of the executive in implementing the fundamental rights and defending the fundamental liberties of the people? We'll take that debate forward. Our second speaker, Aryaman Sundaram, speaking for the motion. Mr. Sundaram.
Justice Mudgal is very correct when he said that the origin of judicial activism was really to reach the people who didn't get justice, to reach the downtrodden, to reach the people who required a lot of help to safeguard their fundamental rights. Unfortunately, that is not where we are now. It started there, like many good starts 3 decades ago, Justice Krishnayer and other eminent judges who started it. Today, we have gone into a different sphere. And when we talk about judicial activism today, invariably this activism means intruding into the executive functions. By executive, I include the legislative functions, which goes against the very basis of the separation of power. Let us not forget that essential to the Indian democracy, an essential part of our constitution, is the separation of power. And no matter how great the excuse, how great the felt justification may be, that is one Lakshman Rekha which should not be crossed, because it strikes at the basis of a democracy. My whole concern with judicial activism are what I call the 4 C's. The first is clarity, or the lack of clarity. I say it is the lack of clarity because what is judicial activism? When does judicial activism cross that very thin line and become judicial overreaching? When does it cross yet another thin line and become judicial jingoism? There has to be some kind of clarity as to the limits within which this judicial activism can be exercised. It can be exercised to safeguard fundamental rights. In fact, that is the duty of the judiciary. There is no doubt about it. But when you go into policy, you are intruding into executive function, and there is a complete lack of clarity as to where that Lakshman Rekha lies. The second is consistency, or the lack of consistency. I say this because, unlike the Supreme Court of the United States, which sits en masse, all judges of the Supreme Court sit together for every case, or judges of the Supreme Court of England, where they sit at least 5, in India, invariably judges sit in benches of 2, rarely 3, and even more rarely 5. So in effect, you have 12 different benches of the Supreme Court. Each decision of any one bench of the Supreme Court is a decision of the Supreme Court itself. So whereas one bench may feel it is the judicial function to be active and to involve itself into an executive function in some way or the other, another bench may think to the opposite and say this is no role at all for the judiciary to play. And therefore, there's a lack of consistency. The third big problem I find is concession, the third big C, concession by the executive, which always is the rule. A weak executive, a weak parliament, a weak government gives rise to a strong judiciary. And unfortunately, as we have found in the past, a very strong executive weakens a judiciary, which we had about 40 years ago. The fact of the matter is that this concession by the executive is actually allowing the judiciary to overreach in many cases. And finally, the last C, an area which really concerns me and which worries me, is the area of what I call conflict. Why conflict? Who is to decide whether the judicial activism is overreaching and intruding into executive powers or not? We are talking about a matter where you have, in the separation of powers, the judiciary on one side, the executive on the other. We have a case where the question arises, is the judiciary or the judicial activism really impinging on executive action? And who is to decide that? One of the parties to the very cause, the judiciary itself. The judiciary decides whether it is actually intruding into executive functions or not. It is like a dispute between A and B, and you ask A to decide the dispute. Now, the fact of the matter is, the Constitution is very clear in the constitutional functions of the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. As far as possible, we have to stick to it, however tempting it may be otherwise. I just want to conclude my introductory comments with what Justice Frankfurter, the famous judge of the Supreme Court of the United States, said. If judges want to be preachers, they should dedicate themselves to the pulpit. If they want to be basic policymakers, Parliament is their place. Judges who do both are most indefensible offenders in government under law. And I quote a judge of the Supreme Court of the United States who said this while sitting as a judge of the Supreme Court.
To which it can also be said that Thomas Jefferson also said that the execution of the law Mr. Sundaram, is more important than the making of them. And when the executive fails in the execution of the law, the judiciary therefore has to intervene, as it did on the 2nd of February 2012, when it gave its phenomenal two-judgment.
But it cannot make the law. It can ensure execution of law, but it cannot itself make law. While it can say something has been wrongly done by the government, or something ought to be done, it cannot say how the government is to do it.
Since I have committed the cardinal sin of being unable to restrain myself once again into the debate, I welcome our third speaker today, Mr. T.S.R. Subramaniam, on the subject of judicial activism and its whether it encroaches into executive powers.
Thank you, Arnab. Let me start with the first point that I am not a constitutional expert like Justice Mudgal or Ariman Sundaram. I am only an observer who has seen the Constitution working in practice over the past 30, 40, 50 years. Let me make a comment on the Constitution in my own limited observation. The second one, Mr. Sundaram, is India is not America. The conditions are different, situation is different, politics is different. Politics is different. In the American system, all power is given to one person. The huge checks and balances are there in the form of the parliament, parliamentary committees. Every appointment has to be cleared, including Thomas appointment, by a parliamentary committee. It is not given. It is not given to the executive to do that. In the Indian context, we have had I hope I will not be held up for contempt before parliament. If in the past 60 years, if the parliament had met only for 3 days every year to pass the budget and pass the laws and give a vote of confidence, would the country have been any worse than they are today, or any better off? I go back to the Constitution on what is the Supreme Court, or the Apex Court, or the judiciary supposed to do. I am now reading from the Constitution. Ariman Sundaram said that they can't be judge, jury, and executioner or prosecutor. The first promise of the Constitution is justice for all citizens. That's the first promise, very first sentence. It defines justice, social, economic, political, all-encompassing.
Correct.
So therefore, right from the beginning, the Constitution we have given ourselves gives the Supreme Court as the final arbiter, the final umpire. Naturally, players don't want umpires, particularly powerful players. The Indian system has not been blessed with checks and balances. And therefore, those in power for the last 60 years, we have seen what happened to the Lokpal. They don't want any umpire to encroach into their territory. And this is clearly, we hear the umpire is coming into his own because the players are misbehaving. I think their entry is permitted. The Supreme Court clearly has the right to intervene. If the right to life is affected, quality of life is affected, directive principles are not met. Article 14, 21, 32. I would go further to say, if in these circumstances, when you see abysmal poverty levels, when you see the worst education system in the world, when Indian health conditions are inferior to sub-Saharan Africa, the Supreme Court not only has the powers, it has got the duty to intervene. They have to tell the executive that these are areas you must come in and do something about. It is very important. I think there is no Lakshman Rekha. If there is a Lakshman Rekha, that Rekha, as Justice Mudgal said, is to be established from time to time by the court itself. And the powers of the court are inherent. They are not given by you or I. They are not given by the judiciary, by the executive. They are not given by the parliament. The powers are inherent. There is no question of overreach and jingoism. They are only doing their duty. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Subramaniam, for joining me on the debate with your introductory comments. I now move to MN Singh, who is speaking today for the motion against judicial overreach. Mr. MN Singh.
Well, maybe because of the excessive use or the overuse of judicial intervention, this word judicial activism has a very negative connotation. I do not know how many of you will agree with this contention of mine, but in the recent past, this excessive exposure of the use of this phenomenon has created a kind of a negative feeling among the masses, and that is why probably it has become a subject matter of debate today. If it had not had that negative connotation, probably would not have been sitting here discussing this issue. Now, judicial activism is something which I have only one contention in this regard. Judicial activism, when intervention acquires the dimension of populism, or what somebody said, jingoism, or when it becomes a case of a judicial overreach, then I don't think you can blame me or the ones who feel like me if I feel that it is a case of a negative connotation. My contention is that anyone who is in a position of power should not be an activist. My first basic premise. Anyone who enjoys the state power, power under the law, cannot at the same time be an activist. Why? Because activism, an activist is one who brings an issue of public interest in the public domain and invites public debate. What does a judge do when he becomes an activist? There is no scope for a public debate. And therefore, I feel that when a judge becomes an activist, it becomes a one-sided, unidirectional mechanism, which what the parliament of the people should have been doing, the judges start doing in the courtroom, and the problem arises there. There is a great possibility that the judiciary itself may acquire enormous power, which may not be very good in the interest of the democracy. One. Now, looking at the whole thing in this background, I feel, you see, judicial activism is a term which cannot have one single definition. It may encompass anything from, say, simply lambasting the government authorities for the so-called use, misuse of the authority or non-use of authority. It may also include a case of judiciary acquiring legislative powers and creating laws on public issues without having any public debate.
Mr. Evan Singh, sorry to intervene there because I want to give everybody equal turn. I am enjoying only that part where you say that decisions are taken in the absence of public interest because the courts say there is too much debate.
I will close it by a few.
And you say you want, there is too little debate.
I know, I'm becoming a little too vocal, so you want to cut me short.
Yes, I concede I do.
But I will close it simply by just give me a minute more. I feel when I said that power and activism cannot go hand in hand, it implies that there has to be a certain amount of accountability. Yes. The drawing, the Lakshman Lekha means we are still leaving the matter open.
Yes.
There has to be certain accountability in what process.
Sure.
One court said, question the investigating agency, why ever not arrested? And then therefore the investigating agency has gone head over heels arresting the people. Now what if tomorrow at the end of the investigation it is found that they are not involved?
Yeah,
the judges cannot be, the judges have certain, they are immune from any action.
Mr. Singh, in February 2010, I'm not just trying to cut you short, but in February 2010, a group of top politicians, military officers, were allotted flats worth crores in your city. And I want to know from you, what the police force, the politicians, what the entire executive and the bureaucracy did in the Adarsh.
I am saying, when the High Court orders the registration of an FIR, can the High Court also order, in the same order, that you must seize the property of the gentleman?
Mr. Subramanian Swamy is thinking on the other side.
No. You see,
Mr. Swamy is thinking.
Now,
Mr. Subramanian Swamy is convinced I was invited by a moderator.
You
and
said
who has turned into a panelist.
You
and he will have to moderate the rest of the debate.
You said that judiciary should only make laws, not execute
just
laws.
Before that,
this is precisely what the judiciary is doing today.
Opened not by the judiciary but by Arnab Goswami.
Judiciary is doing today. They are not only making laws, they are executing laws.
Thank you
they
very much.
Police officers.
I open up one second. Interventions will come, rebuts will come on the other side, and I already have Mr. Subramanian Swamy on his legs. Was 2G? a justification of judicial activism? Ms. Swamy, your three to four minutes.
First of all, are you going to give me as much time as you gave Mr. Singh?
I will give you...
Equal debate.
That question is asked as a politician, not as a lawyer.
As long as somebody from your side is willing to cut that. Go ahead, sir. Please go ahead, Mr. Swamy.
Well, first of all, this topic is framed in with loaded words. The words activism, compromise, these are loaded words. And I don't want to take up time explaining what the definitions of these terms mean. But it's a well-known fact that the Constitution is the supreme document, and all institutions draw their position and power from the Constitution. But the judiciary has been given the responsibility to interpret the Constitution. This responsibility is not with any other, whether it's executive or parliament and so on. They have no right to interpret the Constitution, only the judiciary can. So there's a very direct responsibility placed on the judiciary to intervene where the Constitution is not being followed. Now, I have four questions. First is that if the government fails to act, then what does a citizen have by way of relief? I had filed a petition recently where I had written to the government saying that Ram Setu is an ancient monument and it should be recognized as an ancient monument and declared a national heritage monument. The government came to the court and said, we will not say yes, no, or be neutral. Now, how do I get relief? The only way I can get relief is by the court intervenes and says, as the court did, they said, if you don't take a stand, then we will hear Mr. Swamy and give our decision. So here is a case where the government has not doing its duty. It's not a question of the judiciary impinging on the government's activity. The government has abdicated, and therefore the judiciary has to see that my constitutional rights are protected. Second question. If there is something arbitrary and illegal, how do I rectify it? In the 2G matter which you mentioned, Mr. Raja issued a press release on 10th of January 2008 at 2:45 p.m., in which he said, which the press release said, that those who want licenses should come between 3:30 and 4:30, which is 45 minutes after that, with a demand draft of 1651 crore rupees. Now, I can't get a 1 crore demand draft in 10 days. How can anybody in 45 minutes get 1651 crores? Obviously, that some people had advance information. They had already got the demand draft, and they were all ready. And some of them were, in fact, sitting in Mr. Raja's room. So they didn't even have to go to the building to deliver. Now, should not the government intervene? Such a huge loss was caused. And a minister called Mr. Kapil Sibal says that the loss was zero. People said he's not to be blamed because he doesn't know how to count beyond zero. Now, here in Tamil Nadu, the chief minister says my birthday is coming. So 1,451 hardened criminals who are serving life sentence for murder, rape and so on are to be released in celebration of my birthday. Now, either the chief minister has kinship with these 1,451, but he releases it, how do I stop it? I have to go to court and say that my fundamental right has been affected. And the courts have intervened and they are now considering the matter. So therefore, to say Lakshman Rekha, let me say here too, had Sita not crossed the Lakshman Rekha, Ravan would never have been killed. So sometimes crossing of Lakshman Rekha is necessary. Then there is a question of your rights being denied during the state of emergency, which Mrs. Gandhi proclaimed as a constitutional measure. The Attorney General went to the court and said, we can now take the life of any person without a trial at all. which was totally against. But for the judiciary at that time, there would have been no sanity at all brought in the implementation of the emergency. So we owe the freedom that we have today, the luxury of freedom, to the judiciary intervention at that stage. Finally, the judiciary has done a great service to our country by limiting the amending power of Parliament. Earlier on, if two-thirds majority you had in Parliament, you could amend anything in the Constitution. In fact, you could declare anybody as a king or queen. There was some suspicion that Mrs. Gandhi was preparing to be declared as the Queen of India. And it just before that, in 1973, the Supreme Court said, no, Constitution is above everybody else. Parliament is a creature of the Constitution. Parliament is not supreme. Anyone who says Parliament is supreme is wrong. And that Parliament cannot amend the Constitution beyond its shape. There is a basic structure, and that basic structure has to be maintained. So therefore, if this is what you call as judicial activism, and if this is what you call as compromise, very good, that's what we want.
Dr. Subramanian Swamy, it can also be argued that you have used all the examples which you have used today. I can see that you've stood up to respond. But that all the examples you have used today are merely aberrations, which you are using today to pass a sweeping generalization on the system.
Give me an example which is not an aberration. Today, aberration is the rule, normality is the exception.
In that case, I take that argument. I take that argument and ask Mr. Kaur. Mr. Kaur, you have been CAG of India. We talk about 2G. Everyone questions the CAG nowadays, except Mr. Swamy. Now, what do you do when there is a case like 2G? And while talking and delivering the 2G judgment, I'd like to quote, the court said very clearly, it is our duty, we are duty bound to strike down policies that violate constitutional principles or were contrary to public interest. Now I know that bureaucrats and politicians have a problem when the courts take over public interest. But who defends public interest? What would happen on the CVC judgment, 2G, Adarsh, black money? Would the bureaucrats be able to do the job? Floor is yours, and then I'd like to open this up to debate to our other panelists who want to respond to the specific points made on the other side. Yeah. Quick interventions are coming up. There's going to be an open debate in 2 minutes. Please, sir, Mr. Kaur, your comments.
I have the advantage of having heard the other participants, so I'll take a more moderate view because much can be said on both sides. The point is that we are discussing judicial activism and the compromise of executive powers. I don't think we have passed a stage when we could consider activism a pejorative. So that point I want to make clear. Number two, I have 2 points basically. One is a general point and one is a specific point. The general point is, why this selective activism? Judicial activism in full play in the PIL jurisprudence. No play at all in traditional cases. Cases keep on lying for years and they are increasing. In fact, the judiciary is losing public trust, not gaining it, because of the delays in the courts. There is no activism we see on that side. Nothing new, no innovation. The entire sort of courtroom dynamics has been changed by the PIL jurisprudence. But we don't see a similar change on the normal, traditional jurisprudence. Now, why this selective activism? Do the judges enjoy passing PIL cases and like ignoring their normal work for which they were originally recruited? We would, as people, like to know. I'm speaking as a citizen. Number 2 point is the specific point. The specific point is this, that we must, you see, unbounded activism or unbounded anything is basically undemocratic. And therefore, we must have some kind of a rational distinction between legitimate activism and illegitimate activism. Unless we have that, we will have kind of a judicial chaos. We can work into it. You must have heard about Judge Dredd. Judge Dredd type of dystopia can emerge in a situation where there's unlimited activism without any definition of the boundaries of activism. Who can do this? Not the parliament. The parliament has proved itself enervated in effect. It is distracted and almost dysfunctional. So forget the parliament. I still have faith in our Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has an immense amount of capacity for self-correction. Now, critics may say contradiction, but I would like to say self-correction. The Supreme Court should be used as the forum to which citizens can approach and get a clarity between what is legitimate and what is illegitimate when judges decide cases of activism. That is my position.
Mr. Kaul, thank you very much. No. Thank you, and a round of applause for the opening comments of our panelists today. Just food for thought as I open up to responses. To this side, I want to say, give me one concrete example and challenge the other side tonight on where, under the garb of judgments, the judiciary is forgetting the separation of powers rule under Article 50 of our Constitution. Give me one concrete example. To the other side, I would say tonight, what about the secrecy within the judiciary? Should it be opened up to the RTI? How are judges appointed? Why is there a cloak and dagger manner in which that is happening? Relevant questions. Do we have interventions? Yes. If you have interventions, please raise your hand.
I also
want to say your intervention should be specific and to the other person, brief and pointed.
Can I start with responses to Mr. Aryamasundaram and Mr. Singh?
You have intervention to him?
Yes.
Choose one person.
One, he said that who will
that
decide?
Is to whom?
Who will decide?
Your point is to Mr. Sundaram?
Sundaram.
Go ahead.
He said there are three C's and he said who will decide? The parliament enacts the law, the executive carried out the mandate of the law, and the judiciary decides what the law is. So it has to be the judiciary. Would you like the executive to decide what the law is?
Right. Mr. Sundaram.
No, and I want to say one more thing. So not only is the judiciary the first and the second empire, it is also the third empire.
Okay, well, Mr. Sundaram, would you like to respond? And you have a counter question as well. Who is that to?
I want to make one thing very clear. I think somewhere along the line, all my friends who are supporting or who are against the motion appear to have got it completely confused. You talk about fundamental rights being affected, the court's interference, and you call that judicial activism. That's not judicial activism, that's judicial functioning. All the examples which have been given, every single one given by Mr. Swamy, by the others, every single example, our cases, I will tell you what is activism in answer to Mr. Goswami's question in a moment. What you have been talking about is judicial functioning. If the judiciary doesn't do that, there is no judiciary. If a fundamental right is affected, it is the duty of the judiciary to act. When we talk about judicial activism, in the sense that I understand it to compromise executive powers, I do not mean... Allow me to finish, please. Allow me to finish. I do not mean... It cannot mean judicial activism which corrects misuse of government powers. That is the duty of the judiciary. We are talking about judicial activism compromising executive powers. In other words,
example.
Where the judiciary starts laying down policy. For example, take our 2G case since Mr. Subramanian Swamy has spoken about
it. I was waiting for this
moment. Now, Mr. Subramanian Swamy has spoken about the 2G case. He was very correct. The judiciary struck down what was wrongly done. Having struck down what was wrongly done, what is the next step? Is the next step then to say, henceforth, all properties shall be given only by auction? Isn't that laying down policy?
That now, is a question being asked. That is a question being asked in the presidential reference which was passed by the cabinet last week.
Now you ask me what is judicial activism. One moment. You ask me what is judicial activism. That is judicial activism, which I am saying is impinging on executive powers.
So you support the 122 licenses being revoked?
No.
You support the fact.
I am sorry.
He's the advocate for those culprits.
I am very sorry. I do not support.
You support
Mr.
the
Swamy.
You are an advocate.
And Mr. Swamy used to interrupt me in the very same way, even in court.
Okay, he has a right to rebut. He has a right to rebut. Since it's 2G, I'd like Mr. Swamy to
rebut. Yeah, let him rebut.
And brilliant lawyers are dangerous. That's why.
Aren't you?
You know.
Yes.
Now, don't allow dangerous people to take over the executive functions.
Are you conceding? Are you conceding to him?
No, I am not conceding.
Let me just say one thing.
I am not conceding.
As far as the license is concerned, nobody has challenged it. Even the companies have not challenged it. Including your clients, they have not challenged it.
It's a judgment of the Supreme Court.
The question where the court observed that where natural resources are concerned, the best procedure is auction.
Was it an observation or was it a direction?
That is what is the clarification being sought. There is in the Constitution and in the provisions of functioning of the judiciary to review such things. So here you are saying they have crossed the limits. The court said, okay, this is an arguable proposition and they issued notice to me to ask for my view. In my opinion, it is time, knowing the number of crooks in the government that have come to occupy it, that we should now have a general rule that where it comes to natural resources, it should be auctioned. And the court was right in
Therefore, but is that the therefore, question is not whether the court was right or wrong. I, for one, may very well feel it was right. Sir, the question is, should the court do it or should Parliament do it?
It is because,
that is the question.
No, it is because it is my fundamental right to see that the proper price is realized by the government, the
and
government
which fundamental
revenue,
right
by
are you
auction,
referring to, Mr. Swamy?
And the court has upheld my fundamental right.
Which fundamental right are you referring to?
I am referring.
One minute, gentlemen. I'd like to say here that in the case which you are referring to, the 2G case, the presidential reference which has been asked to, it seeks to know if the court's order amounts to policy making.
Second.
Right? That's the fundamental point.
Yes.
It asks whether as a broad principle it amounts to the formulation of a policy. In other words, the government is asking the Supreme Court, are you getting into policy formation? Is the government
there
trying to corner?
Arnab, the only issue here is, as he said, it has to be normally auctioned. Unless in exceptional circumstances, it is not auctioned for reasons to be specified. That is
the law is already laid down in the Balco case. That it is always free not to auction.
I think
it's already laid down by a three-judge bench that it's always free not to auction. I think depending on the exigency.
We are now getting a second rebut. Second rebut is to TSR Subramaniam. And who's your point to?
To call.
To Mr. Kaur, yes. Go ahead.
Now, incidentally, this is not a rebuttal, this is a support of what you said.
And now that's the IAS lobby.
No. In the full spirit of brotherhood, which we both belong to.
Don't do this to me.
We today talked of judicial overreach. I am glad Ariman Sundaram has said that this is normal function, then we have nothing to say after that. Any exceptions, of course, should be condemned. Any adventure should be condemned.
In which case,
for call, the failure of judiciary is precisely the areas he has talked about. The judiciary has not looked after litigants. It has looked after lawyers. The judiciary.
I don't charge anything.
No. Judiciary takes.
Are you asking a question?
No.
I make comment for him.
It takes 20 years to decide. Justice delayed is justice denied. Even though the prosecution, investigation, or arena in the executive area, they have not done overreach, disciplined prosecution, and disciplined investigation to ensure. They give liberal adjournments to favor the lawyers at the expense of the litigants. I'm afraid I have offended.
You not offended
but,
me.
But the fact
Arya
is,
may will testify.
No. I feel there are areas where more activism is required by the judiciary to perform their own functions.
Mr. Sundaram, as a lawyer who appeared in my court, will testify that he never got an adjournment.
I think Justice Mudgal would also say I never asked for one.
Yeah, because you knew what the answer would be. But I want to answer Mr. Eman Singh. I think you need to inform yourself of what the Constitution Court is. You said Section 377 has been struck down. It could have never have been done. Yes, it can be done. The court can strike down an act. And please remember, this is an act of the 18th century. Let us not harp on it. It reflects Victorian morality. You can't say the court can't strike down. Court can strike down and must strike down unconstitutional provision.
But Parliament can reenact.
No, reenact.
Sir, but I was referring to Article 335 of the Constitution.
You had talked about 377 saying there was no debate. The case was heard for 6 months in the Delhi High Court. And for 3 months it's being heard in the Supreme Court.
I think this 2G is going to have a walk away with this Mr. Sundaram and Dr. Swamy. And this 2G being such a recent thing, everybody's interest lies, it seems, in that. But some example that you asked for. You see, judicial intervention in areas which are non-justiciable are also taking place. Now,
example,
supposing that judicially...
I want an example.
You see, like, for example, the case of attack on Indian students in Australia, racial attack.
Sorry?
The Supreme Court issued a notice to the government of India saying, please explain what steps are you taking.
What's wrong?
It's a matter in the diplomatic arena.
They are citizens of India. Fundamental rights they have.
Citizens of India in Australia. I mean,
so what? They are still citizens of India. They are students there.
1 minute, one. Let him complete his point. I'll come to you, sir.
Then, when Mayawati is statues and making budgetary provisions, can the judiciary question about the government making budgetary provisions?
They don't stop it. They're there. The statues are there with the
statues
court's
are
permission.
There.
The court's permission.
But the Supreme Court issued a notice asking, explain how
you have made somebody
it.
Complained.
Yeah,
that issued notice.
I have a counter question.
Another question.
No,
like,
Mr.
for example,
Singh, you have a lot of heartburn.
If the executive
subject.
Takes a decision to go on war with certain country, can the judiciary stop it?
No, but my question
when
to you is...
When has the judiciary stopped a war?
Posing a hypothetical
question. You can't. You won't do it.
If, say, I take the example of, say, the black money case. Right. If the court says, and Mr. Swamy's favorite subject, if the court says,
like
where
money.
Are the sources of the money? What action have you taken since you know the money is stashed?
It's very much
is the money is
there is a lot to deal with black
money.
There is a lot to deal with
narcotics, drug trafficking, or something else. And if the court
there is
then
a
says
lot
there
to deal with black money, drug money, and money laundering, and therefore the Supreme Court, High Court, all courts have perfect rights to intervene.
Is it a classic case of the government's inertia? Which has been woken up because of judicial intervention.
I accept that because of many failures of the government,
the
particularly in the present times, ridden with scams and corruption, judiciary is getting an upper hand and must in certain areas.
Let's not confuse the issue.
Why
where
do you say
there is a law which
issue?
Is not being followed or
yes.
being broken, court should intervene.
Correct.
Where there are laws which are not being implemented, the courts should intervene. Where there are laws, that is the area of the court's intervention. What we are discussing is not the courts doing what they are meant to do, which is to apply the law, ensure the law is being followed. We are talking about areas which fall within the discretionary areas of the executive. Should the courts interfere there? That is the question.
I thought judicial activism, which you refer to, necessarily you acknowledge that it does not exist in a vacuum. It is happening because of vacuum.
Because they are compromising executive powers, which is the power of discretion, which is the power of parliament, which is the power of discretion.
Counter question.
To do with the law, courts will interfere.
Counter question.
Today, under IPC or any special acts, there is no law against poverty. There is no law against malnutrition. There is no law against poor public health. You think the courts have nothing to do with this?
Of course they do. It's Article 21. It's Article 21. The courts will
the courts
come
in. Come
it's
in.
A fundamental right.
It's not a law.
It is above law.
It's
fundamental right
yes, I agree.
Is the strongest law.
If you say,
it is the strongest law.
Fine.
There are
constitutional
provisions for those.
Fine, I agree.
And that is law.
I agree.
Nothing more serious than constitutional law.
1 minute. Yes, yes, Mr. Cole. Mr. Cole.
My point is different.
Who's your point to, sir?
My point is basically to the earlier point I made, which the point that you asked. My point is to you. You said, how do you define adventurism from normal activity? I said there are two things that I can point out, and the Supreme Court can look at the entire thing and come
right.
to their own this thing. First is where judicial orders have fiscal implications. Now you are traversing that area and going into Parliament's domain to pass budget. You know the point that Mr. Singh raised about budget allocations for Mayawati. No business of the judiciary. It is the Parliament to decide where it will spend the money. If the money is wasted, certainly, then you can prosecute and go to jail. No, but no one says those beautiful statues cost 600 crores of good artistic money. Unless you can prove that they are not good, not enough, you cannot go about challenging the decision of the Parliament to invest money.
I want to give you an example. To question your point.
Okay.
You know the endosulfan case, right? Since you said fiscal implications, the Supreme Court banned the production and sale of endosulfan, right? And it said that even the life of one child is more precious than all the financial losses that the industry will occur. Yes. And if industry occurs, then on tax implications, perhaps to the government. My question to you is that encroachment?
No.
Is
Bellary
that is Article 21. That is Article 21.
When the government suspends mining in the Bellary district, saying greed has overshot all limits.
Yes.
Right? Is that encroachment?
No.
Is that overreach? It's not.
No, it is not.
Okay. But when the judiciary
because there again, it is Article 21. It is a question of protecting the environment.
It's too important. Look,
it is law.
It is wrong to say that judicial decision.
My second point.
Sorry. This point, then you come.
Well,
The first point is fiscal implications. The second point is judiciary going into areas in which it does not have expertise. That is happening quite a lot.
Ministers do that. Huh? You and I do that. All areas, ministers do that. What's the problem? No, all the experts
yourself.
And get
you
a decision.
You may be doing that. I've never done that. So, so policy making, it requires a certain degree of knowledge, data, analysis, expertise from various sources, and then policy is made. A judge deciding a complex issue, how natural resources should be priced and disposed of, is too complex an issue to be left to judges. There are so many. I'll give you the three examples in this. There is a trade-off between revenue maximization and environment, number one, in the disposal of natural resources. There's a trade-off between the premium that you'll get from a big auction and the royalty. You can increase the royalty three times, get the money over 25 years. If you get an auction, you'll get a lot of money, and we have known, and you have known, Dr. Swamy, that whenever there's a windfall with government, it wastes it. Thirdly, end use. If you'll price coal at the price of gold, what happens to the price of power? So if you say auction and stop, what happens to disposal of water? Will you auction water also tomorrow? Okay. So therefore, you don't. What happens with this kind of a thing, with judges going into areas in which they don't have expertise, is that you get simple solutions to complex problems.
Okay, I now
more problems.
To that, a rebut from Subramanian Swamy. Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's no fun to see an army in retreat. They have half conceded.
On both sides. So did Mr. Joyner.
I have not conceded. They have already conceded that the judicial activism in where the law is not implemented or
that
the law is not
activism.
Properly implemented, all these concessions
that
have been made.
That is not activism. That's now, judicial functioning. That is not activism.
All right. Therefore,
the point is,
he's accusing of your misrepresentation.
I am talking about judicial activism. The only time it compromises executive functions is when it may impinges on what is executive discretion. Not when it corrects executive mistake. Not when it directs executive action where the law mandates.
It is well
judicial activism is not.
It is a well. I'd like to well establish principle that discretion.
Executive powers,
no discretion is unfettered.
Mr. Swamy is taking the easy way out.
Now there's no easy way out.
You are taking a very easy way out. All you are doing is saying, look, when the executive has broken the law, should the court not interfere? We don't need Dr. Swamy to say that.
Yes.
We could have anybody saying that.
Yes.
Now, I want to hear Dr. Swamy say,
yes,
should the courts interfere when it's a pure discretionary matter for Parliament to decide?
Yes, I will tell you the court
under
should.
Under which provision?
I will tell you that.
One second. Let him answer.
Okay, can I answer?
Under which provision?
Former Chief Justice.
Easily.
One, Ariman, I would like to say this, that if the action is totally arbitrary,
right,
yes, the court can and should intervene.
I have no quarrel with that. Yeah.
Secondly, I would like to answer one question which Arnab asked, which I think got left out. What is the secrecy around appointment of judges? I think he is justified in raising this issue.
Thank you.
And it should be more open and transparent, having gone through the process both by being selected and selecting judges. I'd like to say it should be more transparent. But secondly, always the question comes, why does it take 20 years in India? Do you know the judge population ratio in India is much less than many African countries also? And even then, there are certain high courts who dispose of more cases than that are filed. So if supposing 1,000 cases are filed in a high court, maybe 1,200 cases are disposed of, but past areas cannot do
just
anything.
A little, but do you know the vacancy ratio? Do you know the number of vacancies that exist in the courts today?
That's a very stale argument. We can say that about all organizations, including police. Including police also.
The
point made here by Mr. Kaul was,
can a mandamus be issued by the court to fill the vacancies in the judiciary?
It should not.
Certainly not, because that is within a certain... a certain manner of acting. The judiciary appoints in the manner that it has, appointments take place. But if tomorrow, could any court turn around and direct a court appoint judges?
No, but they can ask why you have not. They can ask why you have not done so.
No.
The unfettered discretionary power is not permitted in our constitution.
We are coming to the core issue.
Therefore, even in discretion areas, it has to be a reasonable exercise of discretion. You can't tomorrow decide that I'll have this project going through the middle of the town. There's a discretion. You can't say that's policy. I give you an example where the Setu Samudram project was decided. And they came to court to argue that this is policy. We showed that there were alternative ways of doing it much better. And the court had intervened, and that's how the whole thing has been stopped. Therefore,
then what is the purpose of a parliament? What is the purpose of people going to vote?
Good question.
If parliament, if what you're saying is there is no doubt that we have very, very learned people sitting as judges, there is no doubt that we have very erudite, very people of the greatest integrity who are the judges. But the point is, the whole concept of parliament is that people vote a representative. These are people who are answerable to the people. You may not be happy with the choice of the members elected.
That is not
but when
issue.
People have reposed their faith in them to take that decision, should that decision be taken by somebody else who has not been voted?
Mr. Sundaram, this is something that was decided during the Constituent Assembly debates of in 1948 and 49. The founding fathers of our constitution framed this. They gave a certain degree of primacy to the judiciary over the two organs of the state.
Of course they did.
Lest you say I'm taking a position since you said Article 142 gives a unique and extraordinary...
141 and 142.
Yeah,
141,
gives a unique and extraordinary part of the Supreme Court to do, if I'm not mistaken, the Honourable Justice can correct me, to do complete justice.
Yes.
The court was to do complete justice in any matter that is before.
And let me clarify.
You're quoting it wrong.
It's my turn.
To do complete justice in any cause between the parties.
That's what happened.
It does not mean that you just take up any cause and say, I want to do complete justice, I want a metro put down.
What a pity, I couldn't shut him up the way I could in court. Now, I want to say something. I want to give you an example of the way the judicial activism, even lawmaking, has helped the citizens of India. You know Vishakha judgment. It filled in the legislative gaps till the legislature steps in. Today, sexual harassment of women in workplace can be looked into in public bodies. Now, there was no law. The parliament was not interested in enacting law. The rights of women to live fairly and with dignity were being violated. The Supreme Court has laid down guidelines, which does amount to judicial lawmaking, but it is beneficial judicial lawmaking. It is there till the legislature steps in, and the legislature, unfortunately, from 97 has not
yet to step in. Is yet to step in. I agree with you. But my point is, do we not have a huge area of grey? Which is why I said lack of consistency. When I started, I said there is a lack of consistency because we have a huge grey area. This is beneficial judicial legislation. This is not beneficial judicial legislation. How do we have judicial legislation in the first place?
Please, from what we have heard till now, so long as they function within Article 19, 21, 30 odd, etc., and 142, it's conceded except in one case under reference. You've not heard any other case in 60 years. They've gone beyond that. What is the dispute about?
Justice Mudgal just gave one more example of a beneficial judicial legislation. Justice Mudgal just gave another example.
We are debating this today because of what the court has done in so many cases. But it's broad-based. Has the increasing assertiveness / activity / activism of the court made the political and bureaucratic class very insecure? It's made it extremely insecure. It has made it realize its own flaws in case after case. Does this side have an equal answer to that very basic question? Let's not get lost in articles and, you know, interpretations of cases.
And it is.
Okay, tell me today, do you believe or not, as a former CAG, as a former police commissioner, and as a lawyer,
you can deal with all these problems of corruption under the normal law? You don't, a judge doesn't have to come and be an activist. And all these problems are being dealt with under the regular laws only.
Sir, are you saying there's nothing historic about 2G? There's nothing historic about the CVC judgment. There is nothing historic about the black money case. There is nothing historic about Kargil for profit.
I said initially itself that because this government or this political class is ridden with these scams and corruption charges and all that, you have given a free hand to the judiciary to step in and take that position.
Under the
and
law.
Therefore, you
under
feel the
law.
Common masses,
the
common masses feel, well, welcome. At least there is a judiciary in which we can put our hope. Fine.
Not adventurism, under the Constitution.
No one has answered my question. What about the larger public interest of those cases which are pending for 20 years?
Yes.
Where is judicial activism then?
I've already answered the question. We need more judges.
Subramanian Swamy is responding to court.
Since Mr. Sundaram quoted the American Supreme Court, let me tell you that American Supreme Court in the whole year takes only 200 cases and rejects all the others. They don't have benches. The entire Supreme Court sits.
3 months.
It gives 20 minutes to one side, 20 minutes to another side, and 10 minutes to reply. And then they go back into the chambers, decide, and come back and make the announcement. Here the lawyers speak because they are paid by the hour, so they speak for 10 days.
I think the longest arguments in the 2G case were by Mr. Swamy. No. But judges are not paid per hour for listening.
Arnab, I have to add one point.
This is hitting below.
I think Call is correct in highlighting that in this we shouldn't get away with the feeling in this debate that the judiciary is perfect, they are doing extremely well. No, there are clear areas the judiciary needs to intervene in the interest of the public, change procedures, bring technology, bring new systems, discipline lawyers, help the litigants. Litigants should know if he's happy to come to court rather than he's now running away. There is so much of perjury taking place. Yes. Every arbitration proceeding takes more than a regular case. There are huge areas of amendment to be done.
Towards the end of this debate, I'm now asking both sides. I'm taking a 1 minute. By 1 minute, we'll just be quiet. In 1 minute, I want both sides to decide one example which they think. One case, one instance, one example, which they think will demolish the other side's argument. I give you 1 minute to discuss it among yourselves. When we come back, I'm going to get that one argument from both sides. You can discuss which one of you is going to represent it. Why don't you talk among yourselves here?
The onus is on them. They must produce an example.
You think
we will contradict.
The problem with answering Dr.
Swamy is he wears two hats. At times he's a lawyer, at times he's a politician. I don't know which one to answer.
May I take one minute to tell you that there was a dispute between heaven and hell once because the hell was playing football and they broke the wall dividing the two. And the heaven people wanted to have the hell people build the wall. So they went to Brahma's court for dispute. The hell people brought the best lawyers. The heaven people couldn't find a single lawyer.
Now, is this side prepared with one argument?
Yeah.
While you listen to this argument, one person puts the point of view. Please be all ears.
Yes.
The other side.
I'm going to go away from 2G.
You have to have their attention.
And take one minute.
You haven't got their attention yet.
Yeah.
You got their. Have you decided among yourselves?
Yes.
Two points of view, ladies and gentlemen. We presented.
One.
Both sides.
I would like to give an example of under trial prisoners in Bihar. They were under trial prisoners who had undergone their entire sentence and the case had not come up. It is because of the intervention of the Supreme Court that the lists were prepared and those prisoners were let off on their personal bonds. I would say this affected the entire judiciary, entire under trials. It's still not been remedied completely, but I would say this is an example. People who are forgotten in jails, who are poor, who are helpless, who have received benefit of a PIL.
One point,
sir,
was allowed.
One example from me.
Oh.
RTI was resisted by the government till the Supreme Court directed the government to enact an RTI Act as being fundamental right of the citizens.
Right.
And that has been a great boon to our country.
Okay. Now, thank you. A round of applause for this side, please. Loud round of applause for this side. We've had a beautiful debate, fantastic debate. Now let's hear from you because there were two points made on this side. I allow you to make two strong points, which you think will demolish Dr. Swamy and his team.
I will make only one point, that the judiciary itself has not addressed the ills that prevails in the judicial administration system.
Now, you talked about one single case in Bihar where a judicial intervention saved a prisoner who was languishing in the jail for a long time.
Not a prisoner. Thousands of prisoners.
Sir, you come with me. I was Inspector General of Prisons of the Maharashtra State. You come to any central prison in any part of the country and I will show you hundreds of such prisoners are still languishing. This is one symbolic case, has not addressed the issue.
No, you're, but then...
You are condemning yourself.
You mentioned about large number of cases pending in the courts, etc. I don't think the judiciary itself has tried to solve this problem.
One more point.
Merely by complaining that you are short of judges is not going to help. Fine. Judiciary must come out with a proper reforms proposals so that these issues are addressed.
What about
one
the
more thing? One more thing about police. One more thing.
I gave you one point. Now you can't do that. You see.
He's a policeman. He's a law unto himself.
Sir,
when
it is a professor, an advocate, a politician, and an activist, it's a deadly combination.
I have one more point. Ariman Sundaram wants to make one last point.
Yes.
Yes.
Arnab, I do not think any example is more crystal clear as to where judiciary has to draw a line than in a case where they say something has been illegally done and we are striking down what has been done, and they should stop there and say redo it as per law. But when the judiciary then turns around and says from now on the government and parliament shall deal in such and such a manner with a natural resource and only sell it in such a manner and none other, it is a clear case of impinging on executive and legislative powers. And I feel if that line is not crossed, if the judiciary sits as the watchdog, which it is the watch for to see against government wrong action, inaction, yes. But it cannot replace the government. It cannot preach and then it should be on the pulpit. It cannot equally legislate. For in that case, they should stand for elections and
see you in court.
Well, I see you in court, and ladies and gentlemen, I'd only say at the very end, as long as the judiciary defends liberty, everyone's liberty, its own, the citizens, as well as hopefully also that of the media, I think we will be looking forward to a good tomorrow. A big round of applause to our panelists today for this wonderful debate. And thank you very much for coming all the way. We have three speakers for the motion and three speakers against the motion. I'm not putting the motion to vote at the end of this debate, but all of you in the audience and everyone who is going to watch this, millions of people across the length and breadth of our country will make up their minds on where they stand and who's the winner and who's the loser. Against the motion, does judicial activism really compromise executive powers? In other words, very strongly in favor of judicial intervention, not interference. I have to my right, and please give them a round of applause as I welcome them, Dr. Subramanian Swamy, senior advocate and president of the Janata Party, now with the NDA fighting the 2G battle against the government. Fighting very hard, if I may say so. Former member of the Planning Commission, cabinet minister, someone who's been at the Indian Statistical Institute and Harvard. Thank you for joining me, Dr. Swamy. So Dr. Swamy's right. We have former cabinet secretary to the government of India, IAS officer from the 1961 batch, if I'm not mistaken. He studied at Imperial College London, has a master's degree in public administration from Harvard University. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, T.S.R. Subramanian. To his right, one of the most respected legal luminaries in India today, former Chief Justice of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, Judge of the Delhi High Court. He's a graduate from Hindu College and has done his LLB from Delhi University. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Justice Mukul Mudgal. Thank you very much. And that's the team that is going to be against the motion. The fourth president of the United States of America who said, and you can use this whichever way you want, the accumulation of all powers, legislative, executive, and judiciary in the same hands, whether in terms of one person or a few people, whether by hereditary nature, whether in an elected nature or a self-appointed nature, may justly be pronounced to be the very definition of tyranny. Ladies and gentlemen, do judicial decisions breach bounds of constitutional propriety and permissibility? Is judicial activism a requirement to defend a common man's interest? Is it the last court of appeal for the aam aadmi? Isn't it true that judicial activism doesn't exist in a vacuum? It is forced. It is a result of our circumstances. It may be a result of the executive failures in carrying out its own duties. Some food for thought, ladies and gentlemen. Our first speaker in this debate today, speaking against the motion, strongly in favor of judicial interference, is former Chief Justice of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, retired Justice Mukul Mudgal. Please.
Thank you. When one pillar of democracy is dysfunctional or comatose, the other pillars must occupy the space. When the executive does not do his job, then the judiciary has to step in. You said the example of Lakshman Rekha. This is not the mythical Lakshman Rekha. This is a flexible one. The judicial intervention must be temporary, must correct the course, then come back. If it were not for judicial activism, forgotten and weak sections of our society, like prisoners, mentally ill, bonded and construction labor, silent sufferers like rivers, forests, and nature would not have had any audience.
Motion today speaking very, very strongly for judicial intervention. Now speaking against the motion to my left, I have great pleasure in introducing, it's interesting to have a lawyer speak for the motion. You know you're speaking against judicial intervention to some extent. C. Aryaman Sundaram, one of the best-known lawyers of the Supreme Court today. He's a gold medalist from the University of Madras. He was the youngest lawyer, if I'm not mistaken, to be a senior advocate of the High Court here. In 2001, moved to the Supreme Court, and today is one of the foremost lawyers in the country's highest court. Mr. Sundaram, thank you for joining me today. To his left, we have former Mumbai Police Commissioner, M.N. Singh. He's the man who led the investigations into the serial blast in 1993. He has led all the difficult and sensitive departments in Mumbai, whether it's the Anti-Corruption Bureau, whether it's being Chief of Crime, and he has won the President's Police Medal for his distinguished services. It's interesting to have an IPS officer on the panel. Mr. M.N. Singh, thank you for joining me. And to his left, former Comptroller and Auditor General, CAG of India, Mr. Vijendra Kaul. Mr. Vijendra Kaul has been one of the foremost IAS officers, civil servants of our country. He is also, not from the 61, I think from the 65 batch, from the Madhya Pradesh cadre. He's worked in the United Nations for several years, and today he represents the wealth of opinion that says, no, we must draw the line, and there must be a Lakshman Rekha which must not be crossed by the judiciary in dealing with the executive or with any other part of our Indian institutions. Thank you very much, Mr. Kaul. Thank you to all my panelists. Now, usually in a debate, we have people speaking for the motion who set the debate right. I just want to quote James Madison. Thank you very much for having me here today. And it is my absolute pleasure to be here among the people of Chennai. This is a city we admire so much for its intellectual depth, for its ability to debate. It has produced leaders in every walk of life at the national and international level. And I just want to say at the very start, before I welcome all our participants in the debate to come on stage today and share their thoughts, that I'd like to thank you all on behalf of the Times Group, on behalf of Times Now, and on behalf of myself and my team who have come in from Mumbai for allowing us to bring this debate to you before all of you. So thank you all very much for coming. Should we start the debate? Is that a loud yes? Yes. I like my audience to participate in the debate. My debates are a little noisy, as you know. I am told that I should restrain my guests I say I cannot even restrain myself. It gives me great pleasure to first welcome all my six participants today, who I will thereafter introduce to join me on both sides of this panel today. Please, give them a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Give them a round of applause. To all my panelists, to the people of Chennai, to the wonderful audience this afternoon, thank you for joining me on this very important occasion of the Times Uncompromised debate here in Chennai. The subject which we will put to debate, and there's always a for the motion and against the motion in the debate, does judicial activism really compromise executive powers?
Anybody to look after them. And it is only because of judicial activism do you see that our environment is being preserved, our forgotten and weak sections of the society are getting a glimpse of what the Constitution promises them. And kindly remember what public interest has brought out. Constitution appointments by unfit persons, as in the case of Central Vigilance Commissioner. In the High Courts, some examples I'd like to give you. You all remember in Punjab and Haryana, there have been honor killings. Today, there are safe homes for the possible victims of honor killings for 15 days, absolutely safely, with protection. The young couple is given security and a place to stay. The only thing I would say where the court should draw a line is when it appoints these empowered committees to go into environment, mining, other related issues. No committee should be permanent. It should be temporary. Eventually, the power must go back to the executive or the judiciary itself. The auction has one problem, that if you can't auction land, supposing school is to be given land, it cannot compete with an industry, you know, or it cannot compete with another rich school. A poor children's school should get a school by land by allotment. And lastly, I would say that things like water, if they are privatized and auctioned, then the poor would never get it because the profit motive will prevail.
Justice Mudgal, thank you very much for introductory comments. It can also be argued, Mr. Mudgal, that has the judiciary lost faith in the wish of the executive or the earnestness or genuineness of the executive in implementing the fundamental